Welcome to Paul or Nothing, the place to get all of your Paul, all of the time. Join me, your host Sam Wiles, as we discover the history, the music, and the man behind it all, Paul McCartney. To get in contact with the show, email us at paulmccartneypod@gmail.com. So, I was thinking about breakups the other day. They're hard. We all know that. We've all been through them. Well, most of us have, or will have, at some point in our lives. But it's interesting in which ways they'll kind of manifest themselves. For just over the last 9 months, I've been previously working on another similar music podcast, maybe a sister show called Down in the Hole, where we did every single album by the American singer-songwriter Tom Waits. And I did this with my best friend Tom. Now, we've had our own successes with the show. We've had great fun doing it, you know, going through song by song, doing the analysis, the stories behind it all. But rather like Lennon and his foray into the Plastic Ono Band at the Toronto Rock and Roll Revival Festival and onwards, my co-host had already, before we'd finished, started dabbling in other areas. He started another fantastic podcast where he interviews battle rappers. It's called Battle Rap Resume. But in response, in my own McCartney-esque way, I am making my own foray into a solo career in podcasting. This will be my own McCartney One. I am recording this in my own home. This is a do-it-yourself podcast to help get over the wounds of podcasting's greatest breakup ever. No, but in all seriousness, I can't wait to have Tom back on the show for a future episode, maybe to discuss a Wings album or two. And I doubt he will meet his untimely demise in New York before we ever get back together for a reunion show. Also, unlike the real story that I'll be getting onto a little later, I don't think I'll actually be accused of rushing anything into production to mess with someone else's deadline. This show has been a long time coming. I have been a big fan of Paul McCartney ever since I was a fan of the Beatles. I think that's where a lot of people started off. A lot of people always talk about their favourite Beatle. And, you know, while that can be a bit of a trite subject, Paul was always my favourite Beatle, just for his sweet optimism, for his fondness of the old, innocent, ragtime ditties. And it's just that sheer ability to write an extraordinary number of good, old-fashioned pop songs, both ballads and rockers. So who am I, you may be wondering? My name is Sam Wiles, and I must admit, very tempted to call myself Sailor Sam from Band on the Run fame. I am from Birmingham, England though, not Alabama. And I will be here to act as your wingman, as it were, to guide you across the entire oeuvre of Paul McCartney's post-Beatles work. This will include all of the official studio releases of his solo albums, his time with Wings, the odd live album here and there, as well as the few little-known oddities like his time as the fireman. Throughout this podcast and for each episode, I will be going through the history and inception of each album, how it was recorded, who with what instruments, etc., any critical reception the albums may have had, in addition to as much trivia and factoids about each release as possible. Then, once all that context has been laid bare and the scene has been set, I will go into the songs as per the original track listing, as well as any additional or bonus tracks where I feel it's appropriate. I will explore the music and the lyrics of each song, what I think they mean, and ultimately how good each track and release is. The goal is not to be an unabashed, unapologetic Paul McCartney appreciation show. This is meant to be a critique of a man who has had highs and lows in a career. I am a fan. I will be slightly biased towards his work. I've always been a fan, but that is not to say that he will be totally free from criticism. And I think he knows this as well. The goal is to explore what would be the canon of such a prolific artist, what songs still surprisingly hold up, which ones have fallen by the wayside, and which ones were always classics to begin with. I want to challenge both mine and your own perceptions of McCartney's post-Beatle career and have as much fun as we can whilst doing so. But for the sake of utter transparency, I will admit right now that unlike Down in the Hole, where I had heard everything ever released by Tom Waits before we even recorded the first episode, I will admit now that I have not actually listened to every single Paul McCartney song ever released, especially as we go later into his career. So whilst I will start this show off with a certain sure-footedness and certainty about what I'm going to be saying, as we progress together, it will become just as much as a journey of discovery for me as it may be one for rediscovery for you. But either way, I both know we're going to enjoy the music. This is the first episode, so the housekeeping is going to be very, very brief, so we can just dive right in soon. If you ever want to get in contact with the show, whether that's to challenge any points I may have, stories about how you got into Paul McCartney, any gigs you've been to, have you met him, any particular thoughts and feelings on a song you may have, especially if you have any thoughts and feelings on an album that I'm yet to do, I can obviously read those out when I record the episode. Whether you're a musician and you like to play Paul McCartney's music, I'd love to hear that. Or maybe you just have stories about you and your own Linda McCartney. Please, anything like that, email me at paulmccartneypod@gmail.com. I will reply to every single email. I'd love to get back to you, as these shows are a great way just to start a dialogue with earnest, honest fans. You can also get in contact with me at the Twitter page. That's just at paulmccartneypod. I've just started to set that up, started getting a couple of followers. I like to post content every day, just pictures, polls, me rather ostentatiously showing off my Paul McCartney vinyl collection. It's just another hub for all things Paul. You can also find us on YouTube if you just type in Paul or Nothing or Paul McCartney Podcast. Hopefully I'll be the first thing to pop up. All the episodes will be uploaded to this channel for free, so you can just check them out at your own leisure. And hopefully there'll also be, down the line, a few bonus episodes, maybe recorded with friends, or just little things that I can't quite fit into each episode without kind of breaking the narrative. Think of them as like little appendices for free. You can also find us on iTunes. Again, just type in Paul or Nothing or Paul McCartney Pod. Any good iTunes reviews would be much appreciated, as each positive review gives the show that little extra boost in exposure. So who is Paul McCartney? Oh, come on, do I really have to do this bit? I do? Yeah, alright, okay, I'll do it. So, born Sir James Paul McCartney, MBE, well, obviously he wasn't born MBE, he was born on the 18th of June 1942 at Walton Hospital, Liverpool, two parents, Mary and James / Jim McCartney. Now, I'm probably sure you've heard one or two of his songs if you're listening to this podcast, and I'd be shocked if anyone could actually claim to have not heard one, at least in passing. Overall, he's the most successful singer-songwriter of all time. He's got 21 Grammy Awards, two-time inductee into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, one as a solo artist, one as a member of a certain band called the Beatles. You may have heard of them also. The Guinness Book of Records recognised McCartney as the most honoured composer and performer in music, with 60 gold discs, 43 with the Beatles, 17 with Wings. As a member of the Beatles, he sold over 100 million singles and 100 million albums. Again, in 2009, the Guinness Book of Records once more recognised McCartney as the most successful songwriter, having written and co-written 188 charted records in the United Kingdom, of which 91 reached the top 10 and 33 made it to number 1. In America, McCartney has written or co-written 32 number one singles on the Billboard Hot 100. He has more number ones in the UK than any other artist, which is 24 chart-topping singles. And he wrote a little song called Yesterday with that minor band he started off with. And that is the most covered song in history, with more than 2,200 recorded versions. And it is the most played song by a British writer in the last century in the US. So yeah, let's just say this guy might be quite a big deal, and he may just be worth making a long-form podcast about. Now, before I dive right into to setting the scene, as it were, sprinkling a bit of fairy dust, the history of these events that I'm about to describe are kind of all going parallel at the same time, so there may be a little bit of flitting back and forth in the whole historical narrative of it all, but I'm kind of just trying to build not the historical narrative, but more of the emotional narrative of it all. And also, for the sake of my own sanity and comprehension, I will be referring to the album that we will be exploring today as McCartney 1. As with the sheer amount of times I'm going to be saying the word McCartney, it may get a little confusing. But, that being said, let us dive into the first solo album ever released by Paul McCartney, McCartney 1. And for that, I'm going to need to take you back to 1969. The beginning of the end. So just 3 weeks after releasing Abbey Road on the 28th of August 1969, Paul McCartney and Linda Eastman had just had their first child together. They named her Mary after Paul's mum. It's well documented that around this time, the Beatles weren't exactly the tight unit that they once were around the time of Beatlemania. They were kind of sagging. They weren't writing songs together anymore. I mean, ever since the White Album onwards, a lot of the songs were less Lennon-McCartney. The songs were more just Lennon or McCartney or Harrison or even the odd Starkey. They weren't harmonising as much as they were anymore. And even if they weren't in the studio at the same time when they did it. There were just tensions within the groups themselves. They had lost Brian Epstein by this point, so they didn't have that real figurehead who wasn't a member of the band to kind of lead them. They'd all got their own separate wives now, they all had separate influences, and they all wanted to kind of create different music. They just had these ever-widening musical differences. Obviously George had his Eastern Indian flair, Lennon was heading to a more aggressive and primal type of rock, and Paul just wants to write, as he would later say, silly little love songs. Coupling this with Ringo's love of the standards and sort of classic rockabilly rock and roll, you can just kind of tell that they're not gelling as this musical unit anymore. Paul wanted to get the band back on the road doing smaller gigs to kind of, you know, regain their confidence, to kind of get back on their feet, to be comfortable playing in front of an audience again. Because Paul genuinely believed that when the Beatles played live, they played the best. Obviously, this never really took off. The last gig they ever did was in 1966, before Revolver came out. Except for the live rooftop concert, they really weren't planning on doing anything live again. Paul would go on to reuse this idea later of playing, you know, smaller gigs and building up a rapport with audiences again when he would go on to form Wings in 1971. Now, Lennon, the other big player in this story, had already released Wedding Music, Two Virgins, and rather controversially, the Plastic Ono Band live in Toronto with Eric Clapton and Klaus Voormann. His mind and his attentions musically and socially were elsewhere now. He'd kind of been growing bored for a while, and it's clear that he was going to leave the Beatles. We all knew this. On September 20th, he blurted out these inner feelings whilst in a meeting with the Beatles. John famously said, "The group is over. I'm leaving. I want a divorce." Much in the way he'd left Cynthia Lennon all those years ago. However, since the Beatles were still releasing albums and negotiating several contracts, Lennon agreed to keep the announcement private for the time being at least. Speaking of negotiating contracts, Paul had effectively shut himself out of Apple and the rest of the Beatles unit by this time by refusing to work with Alan Klein, who had been the Beatles manager since April 1969. Paul famously saw Klein as a shyster, a huckster, trying to take advantage of the Beatles, just like how many managers before had tried. The story goes that Alan Klein actually wanted 20% of all the Beatles, which Paul wasn't happy with at all. Each of the Beatles should have 25% of the Beatles, because there were only four people in the Beatles. And if anything, shouldn't a manager just have 10% if they have to give a manager some money? Paul said that this would have been fine if he had just been fighting Klein, but Starkey, Harrison and Lennon all sided with Klein, and they all vetoed Paul out, 3-1. So he was their manager, and Paul decided to have himself represented in these discussions with Klein by Linda Eastman's father, who was also an attorney. Around the time of the recording of McCartney 1, Alan Klein decided to give the Let It Be tapes, then known as the Get Back tapes, which had been sitting on the wall for a while now. I mean, Abbey Road had been recorded and released in the time it had taken to just pick up these old Get Back tapes. The Get Back tapes were quite famous, as again it was Paul McCartney trying to get the Beatles back to a simpler time, a more rock and roll time where they were happy, you know, trying to get them back on their feet. And rather than giving them to George Martin, for some reason Klein thought it would be best to give the Get Back tapes to the Wall of Sound musical genius, hair icon and wife murderer Phil Spector, who gave an Americanized tinge to all the versions of the song, particularly butchering Paul's own The Long and Winding Road, a fantastic song. Paul had absolutely no idea that anything was actually being done to his songs without his permission. When he heard the version that was ultimately released, he was pretty peed, and justifiably so. He wrote a letter to Apple to change it back, which they ignored. Paul went on to say, "A few weeks ago, I was sent a remixed version of my song, The Long and Winding Road, with hard horns, an orchestra, and a women's choir added. No one had asked me what I thought. I couldn't believe it. I would never have had female voices on a Beatles record." Paul was clearly bitter enough that years later, he would actually go on to release an album named Let It Be Naked, which was a despectorisation of the album, which popped the single Don't Let Me Down back in, got rid of all the wall of sound dressing, especially on songs like The Long and Winding Road, which became a nice sombre piano ballad, but for some reason dropped the fun little Beatle banter between songs, as well as little tracks like Dig It and Maggie May, which were part of the charm of the original album. In 1970, Paul said, "I didn't leave the Beatles, the Beatles left the Beatles, but no one wants to be the one to say the party's over." And in 1984, he would go on to say, "The Beatles were like a blanket of security for me. When the job filed beneath me, suddenly I didn't have a career anymore. I wasn't earning anything. All my money was tied up in Apple, and I couldn't get it because I signed it all away. I stayed up all night drinking and smoking and watching TV. I lost all of my security, and I had no idea what to do." The recording of McCartney 1. During the media furore surrounding the lead-up to the breakup of the Beatles, Paul spent much of his time on his farm with Linda. And when some Paul is dead-esque journalists from Life showed up at his front door to see if, you know, these rumours that he actually was dead because of clues on the front cover of the Abbey Road album, which, you know, again, is all twaddle, showed up at his front door, he was thrown into somewhat of a rage, telling them to F off and throwing a bucket of water over them. Realising this might be a bit of bad PR, he agreed to have a quick interview and some photo ops. During the interview, he said the following: "The Beatles thing is over. It has been exploded, partly by what we have done and partly by other people. We are individuals, all different. John married Yoko, I married Linda. We didn't marry the same girl. Can you spread it around that I'm just an ordinary person and I want to live in peace?" Over the next few years at Kintyre, Paul had a semi-nervous breakdown at the prospect of the end of the Beatles. The Beatles were what he had been doing for the past 10 years and the entirety of his post-school life. His best friend and partner didn't want to work with him anymore, and he really was at a loss at what to do. Now, it has to be said, Linda Eastman really was Paul's rock at this point, and I don't see how Paul could have made it really through without her. She herself called it one of the most difficult periods of their relationship, as Paul was pretty out of it for a while. She did, however, come to his aid and told him he could make music without the Beatles. She wanted to inspire him to get him back on his feet, and she could do that. Paul respected her, he trusted her, and immediately started to reassess his post-Beatles career and took his wife's advice to heart. Shortly before Christmas that year, the McCartneys returned to Cavendish Avenue. This was the inception of McCartney 1. When asked about his makeshift do-it-yourself setup, McCartney said he had a Studer four-track machine. "I only had, however, one mic, and as Mr. Pender, Mr. Swetnam, and others only managed to take 6 months or so, slight delay, I worked without VU meters or a mixer, which meant everything had to be listened to first, for distortion and stuff, etc., then to be recorded. So the answer? Studer, one mic, and nerve." On McCartney 1, Paul famously played all of the instruments. He played a Martin acoustic guitar, Fender Telecaster and Epiphone Casino electric guitars, Premier drums, and a Rickenbacker bass, so no famous Hofner. He primarily worked on this homemade album in his home kitchen at Cavendish, but also did some final mixing at EMI and at Morgan Studios in West London. Also a first for Paul, he had written all of the songs. Now, throughout the Beatles' career, there was a lot of Lennon-McCartney songs, a lot of Lennon songs, and a lot of McCartney songs. Earlier on, it was a lot more Lennon-McCartney, but things like A Hard Day's Night was mostly John Lennon songs. But then you get onto things like Magical Mystery Tour and the White Album. The shift then starts tipping back more towards Paul. Here, though, he had written the lot, so the whole earnest on this album was on him. Also, there were no covers. However, he wasn't totally alone. Linda also did a lot of the backing vocals on many of these tracks, almost duetting with Paul in moments. This would be her first impression on vinyl ever, and Paul would continue this tradition of utilising his wife, his muse and his lover in his musical life until the very end of Wings in 1981. That infamous release date. So, shock horror, Let It Be, formerly Get Back, the album full of Americanized, bastardized versions of Beatles songs, former bandmate and drummer Ringo Starr's first album, Sentimental Journey, and upcoming McCartney 1 were all going to be released around the same time. Apple saw this as a major no-no, as it could lead to a potential division amongst paying fans, who may have to choose one album over the other. Yes, kids, this was long before you could just download all the albums off Spotify for free. So because of the creative differences and tension amongst the other bandmates, it was up to Ringo himself to go and tell Paul the bad news that everyone essentially wanted him to wait a few weeks, possibly months, to release his debut record. When Paul heard this news, he was incensed and was determined to release the album on schedule, regardless of what anyone thought. He kicked Ringo out of his house and reportedly yelled after him, "I'll finish you now, you'll pay." Paul was speaking in the London Evening Standard, April 2nd, 1970, and he said, "We all have to ask each other's permission before any of us does anything without the other three. My own record, McCartney 1, nearly didn't come out because Klein and some others had thought it would be too near to the date of the next Beatles album. I had to get George, who is the director of Apple, to authorise its release for me. We're all talking about peace and love, but we're not really feeling peaceful at all." John recalled the situation where he was talking to Paul, and apparently Paul said, "I'm doing now what you and Yoko were doing last year." John goes on to say, "I said, I understand what you were doing, all that shit. So I said to him, good luck to you." John would go on to read about Paul's split from the band the very next day in the papers. What Paul may have been referring to here is the now infamous Plastic Ono band, who, as previously mentioned, by 1969 had already played live at the Toronto Music Revival Festival and had released the singles Give Peace a Chance and Cold Turkey. Lennon had free rein to do this, and it never seemed to interfere with any Beatles proceedings, and so he got to do whatever he wanted, even deciding to leave the band in his head. So McCartney here is saying in no fewer words, "You got to do your own thing, and we hadn't even broken up yet. I now want to do that, and we are breaking up, so you actually can't stop me." I think at this point, Paul McCartney was so not a Beatle anymore that I think he was rather unfazed about them on any level. So any attempt from this outsider force that he no longer had any affiliation or attachment to that was stifling his creativity must really have rubbed him the wrong way. Now, I'll get onto this more in detail later, but there are four instrumentals on his solo debut album, and a lot of the songs have a relative simplicity to them. Some people even accusing the album of having a sketchy, almost half-finished feel. And this does make me wonder, and it brings up thoughts of maybe perhaps this album was rushed, not because Paul wanted the quality of the songs to be any lower, but perhaps it may have been an attempt to snipe at both the sales of Let It Be and Sentimental Journey. Now, am I accusing Paul of any wrongdoing here? No, nothing about that is illegal. It's not even really immoral. Paul is doing his own thing. Could this be possible? Were the four of them in such dire straits at that point that they would resort to this kind of infighting? Would Paul have been possibly able to believe that fans would choose his own album over a Beatles album? I don't think he'd be that naive. Perhaps it's more of just a statement. It really is the final nail in the coffin of the Beatles legend. Not only has the latest album been dragged back up from the dead, but also there are now two new solo Beatles albums coming out. And, you know, remember here, folks, Paul always does get blamed with the breakup of the Beatles. There is that famous photo, "Paul has quit the Beatles," in the Daily Mirror. But we've just discussed, Lennon had already decided to leave the band, and he told the other band members this. So maybe McCartney was just hurt. And he was thinking, well, if John's going to mess up the band in this spectacular way, after I've spent years trying to hold the band together ever since Brian Epstein's death, you know, making up the Magical Mystery Tour, coming up with the concept for Let It Be, trying to keep us all together and motivated because we do work well together, and Lennon just goes off and says no. But the only reason he doesn't say anything is to not harm record sales. Well, then maybe Paul was trying to force the issue here, both by creating controversy and ultimately damaging record sales. When McCartney 1 was ultimately released, it went straight to number 2 in England and number 1 in the States, selling over 1 million copies there in just 4 weeks. The PR. So yeah, Paul had been not a recluse, but he really hadn't put much effort into his public persona the last year. You know, he'd been with Linda and the kids in the Mullican Tyre. He, you know, retreated to Scotland to get away from these end times Beatles business meetings at Abbey Road, just signing forms, money grubbing. It really wasn't for him. as he put it in Melody Maker, he decided to go publicity crazy. And this would usher the many awkward years of ex-Beatles slagging each other off in the papers. It's not a pretty sight. McCartney essentially attempted to use the breakup of the Beatles in order to promote his solo album, whilst also presenting himself as a happy family man. The album itself is adorned with a fantastic slice of life series of photo montages of the McCartneys happily living together at the Mullican Tire, including one of his new daughter Mary in the furs of his coat. The following Q&A that I will mostly read out in full could basically just be seen as a way of Paul McCartney getting a lot of these stupider questions out of the way and making them less painful by asking them himself. It's a very introspective album, so it kind of makes sense. And he's been doing press junkets for 10 plus years now, so he knows what's going to be asked, so he may as well ask them. But, on the other hand, he's also ensuring that he's being asked certain questions so he can showcase certain opinions about other people to the public. You know, are people concerned that there's going to be another Beatles album? Yes. Are people concerned about what Paul McCartney's opinion of Alan Klein is? Maybe not. But Paul wasn't going to let things like that stop him from getting his opinion across to the people. Now, this may somewhat have backfired, since many people may have seen the whole affair as being a little two-faced, tasteless, and potentially rather vicious. And this isn't just from McCartney's side either. There was vicious stabs from all four of them at each other around this time. Again, like I said, it's not a pretty sight. Paul was essentially trying to have his cake and eat it with the press here, deciding to try and both continue the post-Beatles hostilities and simultaneously promote this new carefree existence. McCartney, the Q&A. Why did you decide to make a solo album? Because I got a Struder 4-track recording machine at home, practiced on it, playing all the instruments, liked the results, and decided to make it onto an album. Were you influenced by John's adventures with the Plastic Ono Band and Ringo's solo LP? Sort of, but not really. Will the songs be credited McCartney? It's a bit daft for them to be Lennon McCartney credited, so McCartney it is. Did you enjoy working as a solo? Very much. I only had me to ask for a decision, and I agreed with me. Remember, Linda's on it too, so it's really a double act. The album was not known about until it was nearly completed. Was this deliberate? Yes, because normally an album is old before it even comes out. Witness, Get Back. Assuming all the songs are new to the public, how new are they to you? Are they recent? One was from 1959, Hottest Sun. Two are from India, Junk and Teddy Boy. And the rest are pretty recent. Valentine Day, Mama Miss America and Ooh You were ad-libbed on the spot. Why did you play all the instruments yourself? I think I'm pretty good. Will Linda be heard on all future records? Could be. We love singing together and have plenty of opportunity for practice. Will Paul and Linda become a John and Yoko? No, they'll become a Paul and Linda. What has recording alone taught you? That to make your own decisions about what you do is easy, and playing with yourself is very difficult but satisfying. Is it true that Alan Klein nor ABKCO have been, nor they be any way involved with the production, manufacturing, distribution or promotion of this new album? Not if I can help it. Did you miss the other Beatles and George Martin? Was there a moment when you thought, I wish Ringo was here for this break? No. Assuming that this is a very big hit album, will you do another? Even if it isn't, I'll continue to do what I want, when I want to. Are you planning a new album or single with the Beatles? No. Is your break with the Beatles temporary or permanent, due to personal differences or musical ones? Personal differences, business differences, musical differences. But most of all, because I have a better time with my family. Temporary or permanent, I don't really know. What do you feel about John's peace effort, the Plastic Ono Band, giving back the MBE, Yoko's influence? Yoko? I love John, and I respect what he does. It really doesn't give me any pleasure. But it really doesn't give me any pleasure. Were any of the songs on the album originally written with the Beatles in mind? The older ones were. Junk was intended for Abbey Road, but something happened. Teddy Boy was for Get Back, but something happened. What was your relationship with Apple? It's an office of a company which I part own with the other three Beatles. I don't go there because I don't like offices or business, especially when I'm on holiday. Are you writing more prolifically now or less so? About the same. I have a queue waiting to be recorded. What are your plans now? A holiday? A musical? A movie? Retirement? My only plan is to grow up. Critical reception. As previously mentioned, this amount of Beatle-bashing press and self-inflating interviews had not only lost him favour in the eyes of his bandmates and the public, but importantly, with music critics. Now, bearing in mind these are the same critics who wouldn't know that Lennon was the first to announce the breakup. So, since Paul here was kind of the first to publicly hint that the Fab Four were coming to an end, instantly meant he would be first up for the firing squad. Rolling Stone wrote, "McCartney One is an album that wants desperately to convince. Its explicit uniform message is that Paul McCartney, his wife Linda and family have found peace and quiet in a home away from the city and away from the hassle of the music business. This is a beautiful vision, and like most listeners, I very much wanted to believe it was true. On the basis of the music alone, I was not entirely convinced. My problem is that all the publicity surrounding the record makes it difficult for me to believe that McCartney One is what it appears to be. I cannot help but ask if Paul is really as together as the music indicates. How could he have sunk to such bizarre tactics? Paul's statements drip a kind of unsavoury vindictiveness. Although it's a painful question to ask, why did Paul choose to cover a very beautiful and pleasing record with such tawdry propaganda? Giving him the benefit of the doubt, we must start by considering the music in its own terms." Geoffrey Cannon of The Guardian dismissed it as an album that had no substance. Cannon continues, "Paul reveals himself in it as a man preoccupied with himself and his own situation. The music is boastfully casual. He seems to believe that anything that comes into his head is worth having. And he's wrong." John Gabri of High Fidelity magazine similarly bemoaned the expectation that we should dig his every little noise, and found the reasons for the album's failure were evident in the Let It Be film, where McCartney appeared to be the only Beatle who has stagnated as a human being. Perhaps the greatest disappointment lies in the songs, although most of them could have been saved by better performances, especially the instrumentals. The magazine Melody Maker went on to say, "For most of the trip, it's just a man alone in a small recording studio, fiddling around with a few half-written songs and a load of instrumentals. With this record, his debt to George Martin becomes increasingly clear." A fan letter was subsequently published in Melody Maker in the following issue, which read, "Who does Paul McCartney think he is? We don't see anything from him for almost a year, and then he pops up from his mysterious hermit-like existence, advertising his new record in a publicity-crazed manner. Does he really think we will all believe that he played all the instruments? Let's face it, we're not suckers. It's obvious George Martin had a lot to do with it. In fact, if you listen carefully to the third track played backwards, you could almost hear him whistling." This fan letter was signed by Paul McCartney. In a more favourable assessment for the NME, Alan Smith wrote that whilst on a first listen to McCartney One, he found the album too harmlessly mild, but his views had changed with time and subsequent listens, saying, "Listening to it is like hearing a man's personal contentment committed to the sound of music. Most of the sounds, effects and ideas are sheer brilliance. Much of the aura is of the quiet songs on a hot summer night, and virtually all of the tracks reflect a kind of intangible roundness. Excitement is not the word to use for this album. Warmth and happiness are." Billboard also found it quite pleasant. "The future of the Beatles may be in doubt, but not so for Paul McCartney. His debut singer-songwriter album is a knockout. His songs are freewheeling, light-hearted and affectionate, and his voice is attuned to his pen. His wife Linda joins in at times, but this is a Paul album all the way, and he can be proud of it." Yeah, basically people were just a bit sore because the Beatles had broken up, so we all have to take this with a pinch of salt. The album would later go on to be known as one of the greatest hidden little secrets of rock and roll, but more commonly known was the one song that did kind of break out from this album that we'll get onto a little later, which is Maybe I'm Amazed, which, thanks to a lot of radio airplay, has become a classic. So, without any further ado, let's get onto the songs, shall we? The first song on our list is a 43-second love letter. This is The Lovely Linda.
La 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 la.
this is a song that straight away alerts the listener that this is not going to be a phantasmagorical, overproduced studio extravaganza like much of the Beatles' latter work, but instead a truly homemade album. Now, you can argue that this song, nay, this whole album, is nothing more than a glorified audio equipment test demo, and even Paul admits to a similar opinion, but what the overarching effect that I see is that it's a very effective, disarming and earnest attempt to let the audience know two things. Number one, this is most certainly not a Beatles album, and two, that we should probably, and I mean this in the best way possible, lower our expectations somewhat, or perhaps just reevaluate what we want, expect or even need from any of the post-Beatles albums. The example that springs to mind for me is the Beatles' seminal White Album, and whilst a couple of the songs that do appear on this album were written during the same writing stint in India, where most of the White Album was written to begin with, the point I want to make about this double album is that it was really the first time the curtain was properly pulled back on the artifice of making a Beatles record, and the musical taste of all four Beatles were revealed. It was a double album with very few Beatles songs, but loads of Lennon's experimental and heavy sounds, Harrison's more soulful and introspective songs, and more of Ringo's general saccharine corniness. Our first taste of true Paul McCartney would have been, you know, songs like Martha My Dear, Rocky Raccoon or Honey Pie, a genre which Lennon described as his granny music shit, made up of crowd-pleasing town hall melodies. We had Blackbird, I Will, Mother Nature's Son, three very gentle and sublime acoustic tunes. And then we have things like Helter Skelter and Why Don't We Do It in the Road, which are, you know, just great, starchy, protein-rich rock and rollers. The only element of his repertoire really missing on this album would be things like Hey Jude, Let It Be-esque piano ballads. But the point is, if you're expecting anything other than these four elements that McCartney has sort of pre-warned you about, that, you know, these are his tastes, then you're bound to be disappointed. Quality of each particular song aside, this is clearly the music McCartney likes and the music McCartney wants to make. So if there's any one character in the story that we're probably going to be exploring the most besides Paul, is who's, you know, who's going to be pivotal in terms of the development of Paul McCartney, especially in this phase of his life, is most certainly going to be Linda McCartney. I think it's safe to say in terms of musical muses that Linda Eastman, Linda McCartney, ranks amongst one of the most well-known and influential. Because, you know, Linda basically allowed Paul to do this whole album in the first place. She was a beacon of light for him, both in terms of psychological support and inspiration. I feel like I'm going to have to put a penny in a jar every time I mention Tom Waits, but when reviewing Tom Waits, we had to spend an awful lot of time reiterating the importance of his own muse, Kathleen Brennan. And here, Linda represents a similar shift, whereby after a major change in the recording artist's life, Waits himself was also going through a similar major change in his life as a recording artist. He had dropped a manager, a producer, and a record label. So Kathleen was a spark that got his engine going once again. And Paul's going through a similar thing. He hasn't got his own producer anymore. Like Waits, he's producing his own albums now. He's dropped his old band. He's dropped all his old musicians. He's playing all the instruments on his own now. And he needs someone there to tell him that he can do it. Because he can. This album is testament to the fact that he could do it. And he did do it. Linda also has certain similarities to Yoko Ono. Again, they are both Lennon and McCartney's muses, both from other countries and both from non-musical backgrounds as well. And both artists will use their muses throughout all of their musical careers and will actually play on most of, if not all of, their subsequent records. Just reiterating a point from the McCartney Q&A, McCartney described Linda as a shoulder to lean on, a second opinion, and a photographer of renown. More than this, she believes in me constantly. In Howard Sound's fantastic book, An Intimate Life of Paul McCartney, he wrote, "Paul's blind spot for his wife's lack of musicality, a symptom of his devotion to her, would characterise and mar his subsequent career." Now, I think this is a little too harsh. Linda will represent a very important phase of his career, will define it, for better or worse. But one thing that is always conveyed through these records is that She is his inspiration. We wouldn't have got all of these songs without her. So for that, we'd have to be eternally thankful. The little giggle from Paul at the end of this track always brings a smile to my face. It just shows how like unabashedly giddy over Linda he really is. But you know, he could also just be laughing at the sheer shock of what he's doing. He's playing all alone for himself now. He's laughing to himself going, what the hell am I doing? And he's surprised that he's making music whilst just having so much carefree fun. You know, this makes a nice contrast for Paul, as we know that the last two Beatles albums especially were anything but laughs. The Lovely Linda is a very twangy little buzz of a song. I'm glad he kept it as short as he did, as again, he's not hyping us up for anything other than what the album actually is. It's a very simple track, with that very simple strum, a few basic chords. He's not overcomplicating it. The percussion is played by drumming his fingers on a book to get the sound right. And I love how the beat kind of comes in just a little bit too early, like he's so eager to get this album out and get things going. It does, however, start off the entire album with a certain aura of poor production. And this even carries on, like right at the start there is this annoying if charming little squeak that feels very out of place. And well, I think I'll let Paul explain it. The record is me playing around in the house. You hear Linda walking through the living room doorway out into the garden. The door squeaks at the end of the tape. Now, I'm definitely sure that this happens more towards the start. But anyway, there's a difference between a kooky homemade album and something annoyingly distracting. And, you know, this whole album will put that kind of theory to the test for the listener. Importantly, though, the lyrics are wonderfully sweet and saccharine. You learn everything you need to know about Paul and Linda in just over 40 seconds. The words Lovely and Linda go together so well, it's like they were destined to be sung by Paul. It is a song of many great L's. The alliteration literally rolls off the tongue. Also, you know, with Paul being a very private man, it's interesting to see how he, straight away, he's giving us a window into his marriage, whether this is an attempt for him to, you know, promote that kind of post-Beatles happiness that he's trying to show the public, or whether he just, that his love for Linda is so all-encompassing that it has to be given to the listener as well. In an article titled Paul McCartney and His Not-So-Silly Love Songs, he said, she often used to wear flowers in her hair, so the song is a direct diary. There's nothing, like, complex about their love either, or at least as this song indicates. He doesn't try to over-intellectualise it. It's an album of simple and raw emotions, and it's just a real attempt to cheer up and move on. McCartney described the album's themes as home, family and love. And he's doing a great job of it so far, and we've only been 40 seconds in. There's also like a little solo that tries to eke its way out into existence, to turn the ditty into more of a conventional song, but it's like, you know, Paul's own carefree boyish happiness presents the song from opening the album in any way people would actually come to expect. Again, not trying to oversell it. It's not about making a perfect album, it's about making something and learning how, by hook or by crook, doing it on his own, completely on his own. There is an as-of-yet unreleased version where McCartney supposedly tried to add a small mariachi element to the song, which to me would have taken away both its rather basic, simple sound and remove what's so great about the song in that it's just a little dash of a track. Up next we have the first of the many uncomplicated, effortlessly catchy riffs that this album has to offer. It is That Would Be Something. This song is essentially just one idea that is played out for all it's worth. McCartney knows that the single lyric has enough clout to last, and he really gets his money's worth. The idea of meeting someone in the pouring rain is instantly romantic and dramatic in a very elemental way. It again could be seen as a rather bold statement. You know, McCartney is a man who has, ever since songs like Eleanor Rigby and Yesterday, has been applauded for his deep, complex lyricism. And here he's keeping it very basic, as a sign of re-innovation, a sign of reinvention, showing his new interest, or perhaps to protest against the writer that he once was in that other group. He's saying, you know, this is Paul McCartney now. Luca Perezzi, in his unparalleledly fantastic book which catalogues all of Paul McCartney's songs, titled Paul McCartney Recording Sessions 1969 to 2013, which I must admit very much made this podcast possible. It's just full of fantastic knowledge and trivia. He described this song as having a very hodgepodge structure, but I just see it as being very stripped back and atypical for someone like Paul, who in later years may be accused of being too by the book. So I'm always open to little oddities like this one. This is a very confidently well-layered song as well. I always have like a soft spot for tracks that bring in each instrumental element into play one by one, as it's a very tried and tested way to slowly build up some tension and momentum in a song. It's also another reason why the single refrain isn't that boring for me. Like, I love all the little breakdowns scattered throughout the song, and I really enjoy Paul's little scat jazz shuffle vocals, you know, that... And then who can't dig the drums in this one, which have more of a groovy thud to them than anything else, and then you have some cracking cymbal work that cuts right through this very laid-back song and sparks even more life into it. Paul's voice is also another feature that keeps a track like this from becoming more stale, and it may very well have been in someone else's hand, but the different intonations and deliveries from each repeated line brings a new flair to the affair. Like, you know he would love to meet Linda in the pouring rain, and it shows. Like, I know a lot of people may be like, oh well, this is it, it's not really going anywhere else, is it? Which again may lead to conclusions of a rushed production, but for me this is a track whose simplicity is to be enjoyed, not admonished. It's also one of the first tracks on the album that really act as a testament to Paul's ability to be a homegrown do-it-yourself producer. Like, without having previously read about him recording it at his home and producing it himself, I would never have known. Bob Wofferden, in his book The Beatles Apart, he was talking about Paul in general, but also cited this song in particular, and said Paul should have disciplined himself to have created less and perfected more. Now, I think you could probably apply that statement to a lot of the songs on this album, but I don't think there's anything that would suggest that Paul was attempting to overcreate something perfect, because the riff is still very catchy, and the almost swampy buzz of an atmosphere that this song exists in is still more than fun to be a part of. In the same book, Bob Wofferden's book, he also cites George Harrison as describing the track as really very good. So that's at least one good opinion. Up next, we have Paul's first foray into the world of the exclusive instrumental, where Paul would describe the song as being made with more concern for testing the machine than anything else. This is Valentine Day. This was more of an improvisation than a thoroughly planned out instrumental, but considering the songs that didn't make the cut, this little lick really must have made an impression on Paul, as he chose to include it in the first place. And again, if this is an improv, it just shows how Paul can just crank out these damn good riffs even on the fly. Not that I'm bashing the track, I rather do enjoy Valentine Day, but imagine what we would have gotten if he had applied himself to a track like this, or if he'd just redone it again later. Like, I love the way those gorgeous, twangy acoustic notes resonate us into the song with that sexy riff. Like, this is a song that is more sexual than romantic for, one called Valentine Day. There is a raw passion throughout it. Though, out of all the instrumentals, this one does feel the most like a jam. You know, we have the thwack of the drums that have a very raw and primitive quality. But the standout instrument will obviously be the electric guitar that has, it has a nice element of feedback. But you've just got these high-pitched, staccato, scattershot little pops that flitter throughout the song. Is it the most inventive track? No, but it still is rather engaging to listen to. It's a nice break. It's interesting that Paul McCartney is doing instrumentals on this. The Beatles were never really one to do instrumentals. You did have things like Flying... obviously you had all of George Martin's work on Yellow Submarine, but instrumentals really weren't something that the Beatles did all too much of. So for Paul not to be doing the best instrumentals ever really isn't much of a surprise. And if this is his first one, and it's an improv jam, then this is really still very good. I especially love the bit when the drums fade out and then it's just the two guitars. And you've got the acoustic strumming really quickly and those tinny little notes are giggling away with each other. It's a very nice harmony and they work very well together. And it culminates in a nice slow fade out. Though fade outs for me do normally signify a lack of proper care and a lack of knowing how to end a song properly. But in terms of instrumentals, I think we're off to a pretty good start. You know, whilst he is head over heels for Linda, it is no surprise that he did dedicate this little song to the day when all love is celebrated. Moving swiftly on, and we are onto what I would call the first classic off this album. This is Every Night. The opening build-up is masterfully done on this one. We have this very mournful and self-reflective guitar sound that ushers us in. Then it cuts in with the very stark and harsh raps on the drums, which already kind of highlight the conflicting nature of the lyrics of this track. But it builds us up to a very softcore, laid-back, epic feel. The main focus of the lyrics of this song will deal with Paul's post-Beatles malaise, whereby he really wasn't sure of himself, what he wanted, or where he was going. Paul was being interviewed by his daughter Mary in the book An Intimate Life of Paul McCartney, and he said, "I nearly had a breakdown. I suppose the hurt of it all and the disappointment and the sorrow of losing this great band, these great friends. I was going crazy. I wouldn't get up in the morning, and when I did, I wouldn't bother shaving or anything, and I'd reach for the whiskey." This is essentially one of Paul's first proper songs about depression and the dangers of not getting yourself out of said depression. Yeah, you know, it's rather cute that despite all of this, his endless love for Linda still shines through and keeps him going. "But tonight I want to stay here and be with you." But that love alone doesn't seem to be enough to stop the endless cycle of going out and getting out of his head, whether that be booze or drugs, and sleeping the whole day away. It's an oddly self-confessing and autobiographical track. Again, Paul McCartney is this notoriously private man, especially during this post-Beatles period. Rarely does he bear himself to his audience here in this manner. Not because he's trying to explain away why this album isn't like his Beatles work, but purely because the whole work was kind of meant to be, from its inception, an honest snapshot time capsule of who Paul McCartney was in 1969/70. And from what we can see here, he wasn't doing 100% great. I mean, he's Paul McCartney, he's a millionaire, super-songwriter extraordinaire. He can't suffer from depression, can he? Well, he can. And despite all these other elements in his life that you think would make things easier, it doesn't. So what makes the song powerful is the fact that anyone, even Paul McCartney, can be crippled by things by self-doubt, depression, self-destructive tendencies. It's both very humanising and life-affirming to know that he's more on our level and it resonates. Essentially, what you're meant to take away from this song is that Paul is just a guy. The ironic thing is that the writing, recording and production of this song in itself would be part of the catalyst that would begin to dull and heal some of these wounds. Lyrically, this is the second mention of Mama on this album and Mothers. And as we'll see in Teddy Boy, Mothers seem to play a big part in his life at this moment. You know, the fact that he calls Linda Mama, as this whole album can be seen as to be about and for Linda, shows the significance of her in his life, as Paul lost his own mum, rather much like Lennon, when he was only 14. The guitar work for me in this is also quite glorious, and it's probably as underrated as the track as a whole. McCartney talked about it quite recently, actually, on the BBC 4 radio show Master Tapes, where he said, "That song basically started with a chord. Sometimes it's an idea, sometimes it's something you've been thinking about, but sometimes it's just a chord you like." The chord he's talking about is E7, and the whole song is built around the chord of E. And once again, you know, the simplicity of the song's structure is one of its strengths, as it's a track where, if it was kind of cluttered, then the powerful lyrics really wouldn't shine through. When he actually played a brief segment of the song on the Master Tapes on Radio 4, the host John Wilson actually bit his lip with delight, which was very cute. The little bits where he goes, "doo, ooh, ooh, ooh," is very painfully Paul McCartney as well. This was a song that was written in 1968 during a trip to Greece, but after he jotted down a few verses, it kind of didn't develop very much after that. It's another song he played during the infamous Get Back sessions, where more classic Lennon, Harrison and McCartney songs got shot down than you can shake a stick at. You could tell that Paul was a little uncertain about how this track was meant to sound, probably because of the post-Beatles rejection, as he recorded another as-yet-unreleased version of this song. Paul said when he showed this version to Ringo, he said he actually preferred the version which he had sung to him back during the Get Back days. In the same interview, in the Paul Wings fanzine Club Sandwich, Paul remarked that he would have liked to have re-recorded Every Night, but I have no idea why, as it simply sounds sublime. One last thing from the Master Tapes interview, Paul said on the end of the Beatles, "We used to liken it to the army, where you'd been army buddies for a few years, but now you weren't going to see them again. Suddenly I wasn't having a good time. It wasn't working." Up next we have a song that Luca Peresi, in his book The McCartney Recording Sessions, 1969-2013, called "One of Those Little Ditties That Everyone Has Composed at One Time or Another After Just Learning How to Play Guitar." This song is, of course, Hotter Sun / Glasses. Now, whilst these are kind of two separate songs that smush together in the sort of a day in the life, I've got a feeling sort of way, I still do appreciate the visual pun gag, as the song at first glance does look, as it appears to say, hotter sunglasses. This song is a very nice, almost Nintendo-style sounding track. It does sound like a bit of a soundtrack to a Mexican Latin rhythm film. McCartney just described it as a song he'd written in about 1958 or 59. Or maybe earlier, and it was just one of those songs you play now and then. It has a very fun and playful quality to it. It has that very laid-back and relaxing sound that typifies the whole album. It very much evokes that heat on the back of your neck feeling of holiday for me. The accompanying keyboards that have these wonderful little rising and falling flurries are very, very adorable. You know, you have the actual rhythm. Da-da-da-da-da. And then these mad little keyboards. And the first part, you know, as inconsequential and as kind of silly as it is, builds up to this rather mad, rather kooky cacophony at the end. My favourite part of this, actually, is the glasses element. McCartney had been playing around with glasses for a while and just decided to pop it on the album, really. They're brought in the second part of the song, and it's very unsettling with that kind of bizarre, jarring tonal shift that really does come out of nowhere. And they do feel very ethereal, like this is a very otherworldly, un-Paul McCartney-esque type sound. And I'm glad he's experimenting in these instrumentals, and I wish he'd done more stuff like this. It's my favourite part of the song, and it does kind of pair well with the odd keyboard sound that preceded them. They both got that kind of high-pitched twinge. Another instrumental, again, these aren't bad. I don't find myself coming back to things like Hotter Sun Glasses with any real vigour. Yeah, if I was making a Paul McCartney playlist and I had 20 songs, I'm not gagging to put the instrumentals from McCartney 1 on them. There is better room elsewhere for them. I'm not saying they're forgettable, but they kind of just do exist within the world of McCartney 1. You can't really find yourself listening to them outside of listening to the album as a whole. And they do fit the story arc of the album quite well. They are nice breaks, they're a bit of a palate cleanser, but they're not classics, are they? Then, in the same musical vein as songs like Your Mother Should Know, we have little snippets of what's possibly known as Paul McCartney's biggest lost track, and that's Suicide. And on the 2001 re-release, reissue of McCartney 1, he actually puts the entirety of this song, Suicide, on. And I'm glad he didn't really put it on. If you want to talk about unfinished tracks on McCartney 1, this is definitely one of them. Like, I'm not saying I dislike it because it's morbid or it's about suicide or anything. Paul McCartney himself has said he was suicidal around this point. He wasn't happy in his post-Beatles life. Totally, would a jaunty little number about suicide fit into this album very well? Not really, especially since you consider how little piano's on this album anyway. It's cool that, you know, after the ethereal, otherworldly glasses, you've got the ghost of a lost Paul McCartney song on here. So I actually do prefer it on Hotter Sun Glasses in its own warped little context. But the actual song itself is pretty naff. Okay, so for the next track, I'd be lying if I said I wasn't letting Paul McCartney have his way with songs like this. as I'm known to be a real sucker for a bit of sweet, heartfelt, saccharine serenity, and from time to time, and Paul has always been able to write these kind of songs exceedingly well. This is, of course, Junk. It's one of my favourite, more tender Paul McCartney moments because it is a love song, not to a woman, not to something that can love him back, but an ode to material goods of the world. But not in the selfish role of a hoarder, the collector. No, this is something a lot more nuanced and sweet. This is a song that was also known as Jubilee or Junk in the Yard originally. This is the first of those songs written during the Beatles' trip to India. They went there to seek peace, enlightenment, and spiritual renewal from the Maharishi Mahesh Yogi. I think you can learn everything you need to know about that stay from Lennon's song Sexy Sadie. During this time they wrote 18 songs for the White Album and 2 for Abbey Road. So it's odd that Junk, being the obvious standout masterpiece that it is, didn't make the cut. Perhaps it's just too damn much of a Paul McCartney song. A version of the song Junk actually appears on the Beatles anthology Disc 3. This version, with its stripped-down approach, appears a little more haunting than what we get on the solo album. But the core of the song is still there, the same acoustic guitar, same melody. He does, however, indulge me in one of my favourite demo outtake inclusions, especially with the Beatles, whereby all the lyrics clearly haven't been written yet, so they're just la-la-la the whole song. The song was completed bit by bit in London, according to McCartney, with the bass being recorded at his home, and the acoustics, harmonies and xylophone, which I didn't even know McCartney knew how to play, at Morgan Studios. Time to put a penny in the jar here, as this song does very much remind me of Broken Bicycles and Soldier's Things, two Tom Waits songs, which have very similar themes and explorations. Like I said, this is a song that is a love letter to the inanimate objects and the effects they have on us even in passing. Just that emotional resonance such non-living beings can pass on to us. Paul compares the objects in the shop window and the junk in the yard, and he personifies them in such a beautiful way, whereby both are seeking to be bought by a passerby. I just love the idea that things are waiting to be bought and they can't fulfil their function till they do. The junk in the yard, however, we assume, had owners before, and their tragedy is in their abandonment. Paul, through the genius of his writing and his heartbreaking delivery, makes us able to empathise with non-beings such as army boots and sleeping bags for two. All the items on the list, whether they're store-bought or junkyard, are also quite simple things as well, thereby showing the irony of their mismatched values whenever told the junk is, you know, broken or damaged, and it just highlights the lack of material greed or priorities in Paul. The junk in the song is just as precious and as beautiful as the pretty items in the shop window. The why in the song challenges us as to why we give some certain things more or less value, as in the end, it's all just stuff. I feel the meditative immaterialism on display in this song, the questioning of value and values, is very reflective of the peaceful and meditative atmosphere that would have surrounded McCartney during the spiritual trip to India. A feeling which Luca Parisi, in his book, describes as being somewhat present in the liquid melodies of the whole of McCartney 1. Paul's crystal clear, hushed, almost whispered vocals are a joy to listen to. He sounds almost as fragile as some of the junk in the yard, like he literally could break at any moment. The guitar is so very whimsical, and it does play up that childlike innocence of all the inanimate objects. I love brushstrokes on the drums. It has such a chilled mood for something so ultimately tragic and affecting. We've got some quite dynamic bass, inventive bass for such a sombre track as well. Unlike a lot of the tracks on this album that you could argue are half-finished or just jams, Junk is the one that shines out, as it is entirely self-contained and has a clear-cut message that it effectively conveys. It has a beginning, a middle and an end, and succeeds because it was so direct and to the point with what it's trying to achieve. When people say they wish McCartney 1 was more focused, they talk about songs like Junk. Up next we have one of the songs that first attracted me to McCartney 1 when I was much younger and a little greener, a little wet behind the ears. This is Man, We Was Lonely.
Man, we was lonely. Yes, we was lonely. And we was hard.
Here we are, another song to reflect and convey just how ugly the Beatles breakup was. In the same article, Paul McCartney and his not-so-silly love songs from 2001, Paul says, "I think I'm remembering that it wasn't easy when I left the Beatles. I went through a lot of tough times emotionally. So something like Man We Was Lonely reflects that." Man We Was Lonely is one of the first Us Against the World duets from Paul and Linda. Now, I'm coming at this not only just as a guy who can barely play guitar himself, but also as a guy who can barely sing. But I really don't understand why some people really dislike Linda's backing vocals and harmonies. To me, if anything, like I've said, for better or worse, in sickness and in health, Linda comes to define this era of Paul's body of work. Now, maybe I'm more taken by the idea that they are two lovers that really don't care whether people think what they're producing is any good or not and still do it, you know, anyway, and I find that adorable. But at the end of the day, I think they do sound damn good together. And this song in particular is very sing-alongable, if such a word exists, and you just can't help but join in. I've always felt that if a song is even a little bit mediocre, that it can be somewhat saved by a sense that if the artists recording it are genuinely having fun and have a love and a passion for what they're doing, that some of that can translate over the airwaves to the listener. It can't, like, completely salvage a sinking vessel, but it might make it a little bit more buoyant. Man We Was Lonely really has a rump and a pump to its rhythm, giving it a very forward motion, like on a boom, 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 boom. You know, perhaps it symbolises how McCartney himself was trying to move forward on from the split of the Fab Four. But that fab, bouncy, funky bass line really sold me from the get-go. McCartney has always been kind of underrated as a bass player, even on simple tracks like this one. This is no Hey Bulldog, but he still absolutely nails the jaunty, folky mood and upbeat tempo that this song requires. Of this kind of pinpoint accuracy and perfection in his bass comes from the fact that the bass is always one of the last elements he overdubs onto these songs, meaning that very little of the bass is done on the fly, and it's one of the elements that he really can take his time in perfecting. Just that bit at the start where he goes, dum, 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 it's just so pleasurable to my ear. The little musical segments with the very winding flurry of plucks from McCartney on the acoustic are again another fantastic showcase of his ability to write riffs and tunes on the guitar. It's kind of almost hypnotic, really, and really puts you in that love is the most important thing we have mindset, where you're just ready to listen to Paul and Linda's experiences. It's important to also distinguish that it's Man We Were Lonely, not Man I Was Lonely, which shows Paul trying to mature somewhat and overcome his pitiful self-loathing, really, and appreciate that the breakup was also hard on Linda. Again, reinforcing that us against the world feel. It's Paul and Linda, not John and Yoko. Paul gives us a rather candid insight into the atypical and irregular process of creating McCartney One when he tells us that Man We Was Lonely was composed in bed at home shortly before we finished recording the record. You know, it's hardly a 9-to-5 songwriting attitude, is it? But it does show the carefree approach that Paul was taking, and shows that the only buffer that these songs had to go through was to pass Paul himself, and he likes himself and likes the music he writes. The evidence for this, despite the fact that this is a cracking track, that this was indeed a slapdash job, is that Paul confessed to writing and adding the middle eighth one lunchtime in a great hurry, as we were due to record the song in the afternoon. I absolutely love Man We Was Lonely. I found that I don't hold it in the same high regard as I did back then. When I was younger, I feel like I was more rhythm-based and I kind of like just a good funk. Now I feel more drawn to lyricism and production value. But this song, it's so fun, and it turns a rather morbid point of Paul's life into a very upbeat and catchy insight into his life. Like, just because it was upsetting and sad doesn't mean he's going to let it morbidly affect the song in that same way. So we go from a very laid-back and melodic tune, and are then counted into the next song by a series of sharp, abrasive crashes on the cymbals. This contract is stark, and lets us know, even before the sexy riff kicks in, this is going to be a McCartney rocker. This is Ooh You. My friend and fellow podcaster, Maurice, was talking to me the other day, and he said, "Sam, Paul McCartney is a balladeer who occasionally likes to rock out, not the other way around." And I couldn't agree more, and it's for that reason that I'm so enamoured with Ooh You in the first place. following my multiple re-listens to this album for writing this podcast, Ooh You has risen up in my ranks to easily become one of my favourite songs on the album. This rocky riff is just so raw and raucous, especially when you consider how laid back and chilled the rest of the album is by comparison. It's got teeth, and I like that. Reminding me of more of his hardcore songs like Oh Darling or covering Little Richard's Long Tall Sally. It was kind of produced in somewhat of a skiffle style and was originally conceived as yet another instrumental based on the guitar riff. And, you know, obviously being in this skiffle mode means it includes the obligatory cowbell for good measure. And come on, who does not have a weak spot for cowbell? The bass is also equally delicious. Some of those drawn out notes that just titillate you in the background have this great McCartney flow and twist to them where it feels very winding. And it always feels like something more than just the riff turned into bass notes and really has a life of its own. Paul's vocals are also a delight to behold, and it's a nice balance of the range of vocals that McCartney has to offer. We have some of his best oohs and some of his most aggressive gruff rock and roll growls, especially when he sings that line, "Eat like a hunger." Apparently you can also hear Paul playing some aerosol spray in the background, but I couldn't quite pick up on it. A lot of people point to this track as being actually one of the worst on the album, though. On the 2011 reissue of this album, we actually hear the original instrumental version that this song was meant to be, and it's kind of assumed that McCartney simply whipped up any old tosh lyrics to throw on to make this lick into a song. Some people call the lyrics forced, rushed, or even sexist, you know, things like talk like a baby, cook like a woman, and my girlfriend, my partner, said she wouldn't like me to write a song for her with those lyrics. And, you know, you can't, like, retroactively forgive things like sexism, racism, discrimination, that kind of thing. But I really don't think that's what Paul is going for. You'd really have to be part of the relationship to really know what Paul is saying before making any bold claims. Cook like a woman. Yeah, Linda wasn't a careerist. She wanted to be a stay-at-home mom, as Paul McCartney was Paul McCartney. Luca Presi goes on to say, "The lyrics are generic, but they seem to be particularly descriptive of his wife's personality. I just see them as simple, run-of-the-mill rock lyrics. Are they bog standard? A little. Are they bad? Not at all. I personally see the inclusion of the phrase, ooh you, in the lyrics being a sign of that he's physically unable to aptly describe Linda in any accurate way. You know, he can just say, ooh you, you know, he can't vocalise it. Like the lovely Linda, the phrase, ooh you, has this great brevity as it conveys so much more than literal words on paper, especially in his delivery of it. Ooh you is one of my favourite rock elements on the album. The guitar is absolutely stellar, and I have no idea why it's not loved more." Up next we have yet another I Got a Feeling Day in the Life type instrumental, where it's the culmination of two songs smushed together, described by McCartney himself as first a sequence of chords, then a melody on top. Originally titled Rock and Roll Springtime, this is Mama Miss America. Itself is split into two segments. The first half we have this like very pumpy bass heavy sound with more aggressive similar drum sounds to the rest of the album, and then we have the very Hawaiian vex heavy sounding slide guitar, and there's this great banging piano coda that rings loudly in the ear, and you can just see McCartney on each of these individual elements really just rocking out and slowly bringing them all together. It'd be great to have a music video where it's just all Paul playing all the instruments all in one shot. Builds up again, rather much like the last song, to a crashing crescendo before petering out into nothing more than a very fun little solo drum kit fill. Now the join is stitched together around the 1:57 mark, and it shifts from this thwacky piano groove into a more raucous, heavier rock and roll fare. And to be fair, you know, the join isn't seamless, but if you hadn't told me that this was two separate songs, I wouldn't have assumed that it wasn't just some sort of standard break in tempo and shift in the tone of the song. It doesn't stand out or appear awkward. Like I say, it's a much more guitar-focused track. It's much more dramatic and in-your-face with its rather emotive stylings. And we have this like wonderfully humming and droning bass that just takes right to the end. This one really doesn't affect me all that much. It's, again, not very much a standout. I don't like to waste too much time talking about these instrumentals on this album. They really don't add much, they don't take anything away. Cameron Crowe obviously quite liked this song a lot, as he included it in the soundtrack for Jerry Maguire in 1997, so I'm glad someone does. Again, the instrumentation is not bad, but it's not very arresting. Like, I wouldn't say it's not inventive, it's just it doesn't stay in your mind the same way other Paul McCartney songs do. And as I'm going to get on to later albums, things like Wildlife and Red Rose Speedway, a lot of the non-classics for McCartney still stick in your mind, and these really just don't. Going on to what used to be my favourite song on McCartney 1, this is Teddy Boy. Teddy Boy is instantly characterised by its strong trifecta of opening chords that open up each verse and continue throughout the song. And the reason this was a favourite of mine was mostly because the chords were easy enough for a self-taught, half-assed guitar player like me to pick up quite easily. Yay, no bar chords! But still, it's a very easily enjoyable track. It takes you on a very easy-to-understand ride with a tender touch. This is another track from the 1968 India Writing Pool, and immediately this song, more than any other on the album, has a definite Beatle-esque feel to it, both in terms of the structure and the general charm it exudes. This was originally lined up to appear on Get Back / Let It Be / Get Back, but was vetoed by Phil Spector as he felt the song wasn't up to his production techniques. It did, again, make its way onto the Beatles Anthology Disc 3, and there's a clear lack of enthusiasm by his other fellow Beatles, you know, to almost staggering levels. Lennon sounds almost half doped up throughout. The Beatles feel is continued by the very Ringo Starr reserved and unfussy drumming that McCartney adopts. The song itself does have a certain 50s flavour, with the eponymous Teddy Boy and some possible trace autobiographical references, though McCartney to this day has never actually explained the meaning behind the song. So what is the song about? Well, it's about a young teddy boy called Ted, whose mum falls in love with another man following the death of his father. Now, the kid in this song, with his overwhelming sadness to the death of his dad and the shock of his mum's new love, is almost Shakespearean, Hamlet-esque even. But in that McCartney fashion, the love for his mother conquers any of these negative feelings in the end. Rather uniquely, this song showcases the inception of a storytelling element in Paul's songwriting that he's never really delved into enough. Songs like Eleanor Rigby, whereby he'll inhabit the shoes of another character to tell a familiar story. However, whilst I do love this song, I love singing the chorus, it's a fantastic chorus. Mommy, don't worry now, Teddy Boy's here, taking good care of you. He sings it fantastically, another one I love to sing along to. But the weakness of this track is that the story that Paul McCartney teases us with never really develops as a full narrative with an overreaching arc. Now, you know, again, this is a good song, but it's painfully not a great song. Dropping another penny in the tin, this is where Tom Waits' own muse Kathleen would have been more helpful, as she was a script supervisor by trade, so it could help keep him on track. After Teddy finding out that his mother has another man, basically Teddy just moves away and the song really doesn't progress anywhere on a satisfying story level, and as a result feels woefully underfinished. Especially with what feels like a rather undeserved short length from an artist who is often known for overindulging in the lengths of his songs. You know, yeah, I could just sit here and argue that in real life these kinds of social interactions don't have Hollywood plot beats and resolutions, but I just feel like we're left confused as to what to feel at the end of the song, and that's never a good thing. Then there's Sing-Along Junk, which we'll just have a little snippet of now. I really dig the little mellotron and electric guitar in place of the vocals, but it is essentially just junk again, so for any of you've obviously heard my opinions on that, so we'll just move straight on to the classic breakout song from this album. Everyone knows this one. This is Maybe I'm Amazed. The there's just something about the way the piano slowly fades in this track that lets us know that McCartney's suddenly about to turn a lot of things around for his critics. This is a song that, if at all, lended some credence to McCartney 1, and is widely regarded in most circles as the standout track on the album, and was even ranked as number 77 in Mojo's Songs of the Century. And I'm going to try and talk about this whole track now without calling it amazing or in turn saying it amazes me. This song melds both the soft and melodic balladeer pool and the rocket in equal measure to create something quite unique and a quintessential McCartney track, whereby we get him jamming out on the piano with the speed and classic precision that we all know and love, as well as some pumping your fist in the air rocking. This song was recorded at the piano in London, probably somewhere between 1968 and 69, with the second verse being added slightly later. In my research for this song, it said if you listen closely to around the 44 second mark, you can hear the noise of Paul's drumsticks hitting each other, but you may have to do the listening for me on that one, as I can't hear it. The thing that sells this song are the potent and powerful Paul McCartney vocals. I mean, it's positively oozing with the real passion that some of the earlier tracks in this album may lack. McCartney's voice strains as he expresses his absolute wonder towards his wife. It is easily the record's most energetic performance and song, and more than any other, it seemed more laboured over in the production of it. Perhaps this lion's share of care is more of a display for the love of Linda than a lack of care for the other tracks, but either way, it's definitely the most radio-friendly of the album. Again, it does highlight the idea of what if Paul had spent more of the album doing things like this, perfecting it rather than just releasing it as a kind of unfinished experiment. Maybe we would have got more, maybe I'm amazed. I know some people actually feel like this song is so well produced and all around good compared to the rest of this album that it actually feels out of place. But I feel that's a little oversimplistic in my opinion, as this song is a breath of fresh air for the album and I know saves it for a lot of people. Now, whilst the voice is a real player in this piece, the lyrics are equally stellar. The use of the word maybe is a great way for Paul, or the eponymous singer, to skirt around the hardline definite answers surrounding his raw, delicate and confusing feelings that he wants to talk about. He is amazed by her, he is afraid of the way he loves her, and he is amazed by the way she pulls him out of time. But he's rather tentatively adding the maybe as is the case with all love, putting himself in a great position of vulnerability to express himself in the way he is. The honesty and openness from a man who needs help at a great time of anxiety and uncertainty is particularly heartwarming, and it contrasts nicely against the epic and large vocals and instrumentation that this song delivers. It can also be seen as him trying to just convey such big feelings that he's feeling for this woman that he's almost struggling to put it, again, into words as he's trying to describe them as best he can. There could also be possible Beatle references within this track on the level that he is confused, he doesn't know what's going on around him, and he feels lonely. And all he has is his love for her now. Loneliness will be a major theme both for this album and the next few albums to come as well, so keep your eyes peeled. Paul's lively and dynamic piano playing is such a joy to listen to, as he really hasn't given us anything like this on the album yet, and, you know, let's face it, out of his three biggest Beatles tracks, two of them, Hey Jude and Let It Be, are piano ballads. So it is nice to see Paul sat back at the keys doing what he does best. Though this one is more fun and catchy along the lines of something like Lady Madonna. So we also need to talk about the guitar solos, and I mean, wow. This is an album of great guitar and of great electric guitar. They are some of the highlights of the lackluster instrumentals, but Paul really knocks it out of the park with these two. They are so canorous and melodic, to the point whereby I have no criticism for them, as it harmonises perfectly with the main body of the song. These solos were born to be in this song, and they just soar with that epic scope. It just knocks you back with their sheer force. And then there's that second solo that leaps out of the dark when you just think the song's about to end, and it keeps that rousing wave going. It comes back with a second time, and unlike many McCartney songs that you feel like should have ended 30 seconds ago, this solo is so well done and precise and affecting that you're both shocked and glad it's back. For some reason, this song was not chosen as a single for the album, which McCartney did try to rectify when he released it as the single for Wings Over America. Maybe I'm Amazed is simply amazing, isn't it? Wait, knew I was going to say that. But yeah, the obvious extra time he put into this song really shines through, and the results speak for themselves. Basically, the lesson that this song teaches us is that maybe if McCartney 1 had come out 6 months later, then perhaps it wouldn't be maligned as much as it was. So we come on to the last track now, which is a song that I have given the least amount of time and re-listens to. And it's not just because it's the last song on the album. But let us quickly explore Crinacore. The story of this song goes that Paul, possibly during his boozy, lazy post-Beatles days, saw a documentary on the Brazilian Cree Akor tribe, and he saw what he calls scenes of their lives and how the white man was trying to change their way of life to his. This inspired him to create this very tribalistic and primitive sound. There are some very experimental elements at play in this song, you know, with the animal noises, the rather silly animal noises that he and Linda make, and it conjures up images of Revolution 9 that John and Yoko had been experimenting with several years before, but Revolution 9 it ain't. It is much more drum focused than anything else. McCartney is a fantastic drum player, famously he was the best drummer in the Beatles, some would say, but the song isn't as engaging or as experimental as it thinks it is. The guitar weirdly has this like sweeping over the hills and far away style of guitar playing that reminds me of Jeff Wayne's musical The War of the Worlds for some reason. You know, there are some moments where the tension does kind of build up to this song and you do feel a part of the hunt, which is a feeling that Paul McCartney really wanted to reflect, like getting in, like you were there with them. But a lot of the ideas are kind of all over the place and they never really have that room to breathe and play out fully, and it kind of flits too schizophrenically from one little bit to another. Though I do like the breathing in it. It does, you know, kind of put you in that world a little bit more. But again, it'll be gone pretty quickly. This is a song that is a good showcase of Paul's technical drum playing, but not his ability to write enthralling beats. Then we have, towards the end, some more pointless guitar that sounds like rejects from Ooh You and Maybe I'm Amazed. I feel like this song feels like it's going to be ending the album on an experimental high note, but it just leaves me confused. Like, I don't know what to feel. Like, why, like for me, the only real interesting elements of this song is the recording of it. Like, Paul actually recorded the crackling of firewood and included that in the song. And Paul actually uses a bow and arrow, which he apparently broke in the studio, but he actually used a bow and arrow and includes that in the song. So the dedication to the theme is stuck to, and the dedication to the song is pure, but I don't think the idea maybe was that good in the first place. Studio engineer Robert Black witnessed that the bow and arrow moment, claiming, "Paul and Linda went to Harrods to buy a bow and arrow and a target. We set it up in the studio and recorded the sound of the arrow flying through the air and hitting the target." So yeah, Crinacore, I don't know what Paul was thinking with this one. I don't think it fits the tone of the album very well. Like, if this is a stripped back and do-it-yourself, plain and simple acoustic home album, what is an experimental jungle opera doing on it, especially an unsuccessful one? It really is a weird oddity. So that was the album. Before I get into my closing thoughts, I'm going to be doing a little segment I like to call Canon Fodder, where, like I said earlier in the show, I'm going to be trying to attempt to build the canon of Paul McCartney's songwriting. I'm going to pick a few songs from each album that I think are the standouts, the ones that will and should be remembered forever. The songs I'm going to pick from this album that resonated with me, that I come back and listen to, that I'll be putting on playlists. Actually, I think I might create a Spotify playlist of all of these just to kind of collate all of them together, and you can see what I personally feel is the canon fodder of Paul McCartney's songwriting. And that will be Every Night, just for its pure, wrought emotion. You've got Ooh You, that I just think is the great example of back to basics rock and roll that Paul McCartney was always trying to get back to, and it's one of the closest attempts he'll ever get to that. I'm going to include Junk, purely for its wonderful idea and its pure songwriting and the fact that it sets out what it means to do and does that effectively. And no points for guessing that I was going to put Maybe I'm Amazed on here for reasons that are too obvious to even go into. So if you want to be brutally honest, only about half the album is very good. Most of it is pretty good and some of it is quite bland. But is that really surprising when Paul spent most of the previous 6 or 7 years providing roughly half the songs for each Beatles album? Yes, I do feel, like most people, that the instrumentals are there just to be a bit of filler, to stuff the album, to give it a bit of size and scale. Like, we'll see on Wildlife in 2 years' time that that album will also feel quite short without needless instrumentals. But the needless instrumentals don't feel missing from Wildlife. I think the big problem with this album is expectations. The last four Beatles singles that Paul had written, like in reverse order, were Let It Be, Get Back, Hey Jude and Lady Madonna. So that might just give you an idea of the level of expectations that people may have had, and explain why some people were left scratching their heads as they realised that McCartney 1 wasn't full of these kinds of songs. But again, he had three other Beatles helping him. It is a little unpolished, but like so many other artists, that, you know, this we described as a charm and a good thing. And it's probably just because the Beatles were so polished and perfect in every conceivable way that this was a shock to the system. Maybe if Get Back and Let It Be had gone more of the way that Paul wanted it to, with that more stripped back, do-it-yourself, simple approach, then maybe this album would have gone down a little smoother. Am I the only one to find it totally normal to empathise with the fact that McCartney really might not be on top form straight away? Since Lennon was more okay with the breakup, that's why he may have been more tip-top and ready to go with his first release, and his product was much more well-received. But Lennon too will stagnate in his later career. We can't forget that fundamentally this is a first attempt for McCartney. Regardless of words like genius or skill or songwriting ability, trying anything new for the first time is a challenge, and since he doesn't have anyone to answer to, a lot of these ideas may go unquestioned. People also forget that Please Please Me, the Beatles' first album, is in fact far from perfect. I mean, I will admit, it does all seem a little inconsequential at times. Like, it makes sense that McCartney would want to release a simpler album after 5 years of studio wizardry and, you know, contentious infighting about what changes should be made to songs. Despite what I feel about them and the fondness I feel for a lot of these songs, I can see why some people would see the vast majority of these songs as sketches or brief overdub jams rather than songs. And on a lot of the instrumental tracks, I know that listeners listening to these melodic lines can imagine the way vocals would fit right in alongside them. It may get a little more frustrating that McCartney didn't trouble himself with writing a few more verses worth of lyrics. We know he could have done it. He did it on Ooh You. He slapped some stuff together and it was perfectly fine. For me, this is the first McCartney album I ever bought. I did have Band on the Run on vinyl, given to me by my dad. But I remember I was in a very naff record shop in Wolverhampton in the West Midlands. The owners who ran it really didn't have any idea what they were doing. They sold me an original pressing of Aretha Franklin's Respect for 50p, which was a great bargain. And they gave me this album for £2, because apparently no one likes Paul McCartney's solo work. Well, people like it enough to be listening to this podcast, so thank you very much. I got this album and I put it on. When I got it home, I was rather in love with all these songs. They're simple, they're basic, they're uncomplicated, but they're still written by Paul McCartney, they're still sung by Paul McCartney, and they're still played with the confidence that a man who's been in the world's biggest band for 10 years exudes. To me, it's amazing he got what he got from his home studio in 1969 to 1970. This is a great first attempt at a solo album. It's not perfect, it was never intended to be perfect, and the highs of this album are just as high as any other Paul McCartney fare. Yes, there are a couple of lows, but overall, I love the instrumentation, I love the lyrics, and, well, at least four of these songs, as Cannon Fodder shows, will stay with me forever. I'll give it a 7.5 out of 10. Not perfect, but it's still damn fun to listen to. Right, that comes to the end of episode 1 of Paul or Nothing. I hope you've enjoyed listening to it as much as I have recording it. This is the first album, as it were, for me. Like I've just been saying, all first albums aren't perfect. I want to be improving this show constantly. And if you've got any suggestions on how I can improve it, as well as, you know, any disagreements you may have had with what you've just heard, any Paul McCartney stories you may have, any opinions you may have on upcoming albums, which I'd love to hear, please get in contact with me at paulmccartneypod@gmail.com. You can get in contact with me on the Twitter, at McCartneyPod. Find us on YouTube just by typing in Paul or Nothing. And the same to be said for iTunes. Please lend us some iTunes reviews. That has been the first episode. I am quite shocked. I've had so much fun making this. I know so many of you out there love Paul McCartney. He's just untouchable, isn't he? You can't say a bad word about him, because no matter how many albums you think might not be good, or how many songs you think are kind of just lackluster or don't give enough, he's still Paul McCartney. He's still got this wealth of fantastic songs that you can't touch. So, that's us for episode one. Please join me again for episode two, when we'll be talking about what I consider to be the best post-Beatles release of all time, Ram. Thank you, folks. Tune in for next time. I hope you enjoyed it.